Hi, this video is going to offer an introduction to hypothesis testing. And the hypothesis test is a process that uses sample statistics in order to make a claim, test a claim that is, about the value of a population parameter. And an example of that would be if a manufacturer of rechargeable batteries said their batteries were good for at least 1,000 charges. If we took a sample of those batteries, we could test that idea and see if it's actually something that is supported. So a verbal statement or claim about a population parameter is called a statistical hypothesis. So to test the average of 1,000 hours, a pair of hypotheses are stated. One represents the claim, which is going to be that it's good for an average of 1,000 charges. And the other is its complement, that it is not going to be good for an average of 1,000 charges. When one of these hypotheses is false, the other must be true. So the null hypothesis is the statistical hypothesis that contains a statement of equality. And we denote that with the letter H sub 0, the null hypothesis. And the alternative is the complement, and that is denoted with H sub A for alternative. And it is the opposite of equal. So it could be more than, it could be not equal, and it could be less than. To write the null hypothesis, so together, if we want to write the null and our alternative hypotheses, we can set them up in such a way that they will capture what is being claimed in a hypothesis test, something we'll be testing. So, for example, we write the claim as a mathematical sentence. We state the null and alternative hypotheses, identifying which represents the claim. So the claim that rechargeable batteries last 1,000 charges or more suggests that the mu, the average, is greater than or equal to 1,000. So that is the claim. And you notice that the equal sign is part of the more than or equal to, so that's going to be the null hypothesis. Remember, the alternative does not contain equality. So in this case, the complement is going to be mu is less than 1,000 recharges. Here's another example. Statesville College claims that 94% of their graduates find employment within 6 months of graduation. So that claim is that employment will happen 6 months or less. Well, I guess it's just equals in this case. So here you see the probability 94% is applied to the 6 months. And that's an equal, so that's going to become the null. And the complement is the alternative. One could see this also being phrased as less than or equal to 6. It could go either way. Now, there are a couple of types of errors we need to review when it comes to hypothesis testing. No matter which hypothesis represents the claim, we always begin with the hypothesis test assuming the null is true. So if we fail to reject the null, then we accept the null as true, because that's the default position. But if we reject the null, we therefore accept the alternative hypothesis. So the errors that can happen are when we reject the null hypothesis and it was an accident. We shouldn't have done it. It was true. And type two is when the null hypothesis is not rejected, but it's not true, it's actually false. So that those are together type 1 and type 2 errors. So these are the end results of the test. We reject or we fail to reject. When we accidentally reject or accidentally fail to reject, we have type 1 and type 2 errors relative to those statements. So the decision, do not reject. Well, if it's a correct, then we don't have an error, but if it's not correct, we have type 2. If the decision is to reject and we're right about it, then there's no error. If we're wrong, it's type 1. So going back to our example, Statesville College claiming 94% of graduates find employment within 6 months. Would this, if we make a mistaken hypothesis test, what would it be? A type 1 error means rejecting the null when it's true. So if the proportion is actually 0.94 but it's rejected, that's a type 1 error. And then the alternative type of error, failing to reject the null when it's false. So the population proportion is not 0.94, but somehow we reject it. So our goal, of course, is to minimize the chance that we're going to make an error. And that brings us to the notion of the level of significance. In a hypothesis test, the level of significance is your maximum allowable probability of making a type 1 error. And that is denoted by the Greek letter alpha. And so hypothesis tests are based on alpha, the level of significance. So the probability of making a type 2 error is denoted by beta, and that's the alternative scenario. So by setting the level of significance at a small value, you're saying you want the probability of rejecting a true null hypothesis to be small. We do not want to commit type 1. So commonly used levels of significance, 0.10, which as we'll see corresponds to a 90% confidence interval, 0.05, which corresponds to a 95% confidence interval, and 0.01, which corresponds to a 99% confidence interval. So statistical tests can be designed around the population mean, proportion, variance, or even standard deviation. And when we have a sample, those have corresponding notations of x bar, p hat, s squared. And the standardized test statistic that goes with that are the Z or T scores, depending on the size of the sample, for the mean, and Z and chi-square for the proportion and the variance. So next we can talk about p-values, and if the null hypothesis is true, we don't want to reject it, then the p-value of hypothesis tests is the probability of obtaining a sample statistic with a value as extreme or more extreme than the one determined from the sample data, which means it would fall outside of our confidence interval. The p-value of a hypothesis test depends on the nature of the test. There are three types. There's a left, a right, or a two-tailed test, and the type of test depends on the region of the sampling distribution that favors rejection of the null. And that region is indicated by the alternative hypothesis. So this is a left-tailed test, and we see that the p area is the beta, the area that's outside of where we expect the population statistic to fall. So if the null is mu greater than or equal to k, then we're testing the idea that it's less than k, which is the p area here. So the cutoff value is going to be our test statistic taken from a standard normal table or t-table or chi-square table, depending on the test. And this is the opposite, where the p-value is on the right. And so the null here is that mu is less than or equal to k. And therefore the complement, mu is greater than k. Finally, the third logical possibility is neither left nor right, but both, which is a mu equals k hypothesis, that it will fall in this particular area. So not equal to k will give you the two-sided p-values. And twice the area to the left of the negative test statistic. And this p is twice the area to the right of the positive test statistic. So this is identifying types of tests. Here's a couple examples. And for each claim, we're going to state the null and the alternative and determine whether the hypothesis test is left, right, or two-tailed. So if a cigarette manufacturer claims that less than 1/8 of the U.S. population smokes, then we've got 1/8 expressed in decimals, 0.125, and the claim is that it's greater than or equal And that's the null, is that it's greater than or equal. The alternative is what we're actually testing in the claim, which is that it's less than 0.125. Or a telephone company claims the average length of a phone call is 8 minutes. And we're not saying more or less there, we're just saying equal. And that's the claim for the null hypothesis. So the alternative is that it's not equal, and that's going to necessitate a two-tailed test, whereas the prior example would be a left-tailed. So this is where we come to making a decision for our hypothesis test. The decision rule is based on a p-value, so we use a p-value to make a conclusion, and we compare p to the alpha. If it's less than or equal to a, we reject HO, or if it's more than a, we fail to reject HO. So, down here we have a nice table where the decision here is reject HO, and the claim is HO. There's enough evidence to reject the claim. The claim is HA, but we reject HO. There's enough evidence to support the claim. Do not reject HO. The claim is HO. There's not enough evidence to reject the claim. Then the fourth possibility, you do not reject the null. The claim is the alternative. That means there's not enough evidence to support the claim. So going back to our example of the cigarette manufacturer claiming that less than an eighth of the U.S. population smokes, in this case, if HO is rejected, you would conclude there is sufficient evidence to indicate that the manufacturer's claim is false. And if you fail to reject HO, you should conclude there's not sufficient evidence to dismiss the manufacturer's claim. So to sum up the steps for hypothesis testing, we first state the claim mathematically and verbally, identifying the null and alternative. We specify the level of significance at alpha equals question mark. We determine the standardized sampling distribution and draw its graph. And then we calculate the test statistic and its standardized value, adding it to the sketch. We then find the associated p-value and then use the following decision rule. If the p-value is less than or equal to the level of significance, we fail to reject HO. If it's not, we fail to reject HO. If it is, we reject HO. Finally, we write a statement to interpret the decision in the context of the original claim.